Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Violent Hippie Podcast. So I have my guest, Miranda. Maverick is the UFC flyweight division, and she's tearing it up.
Yeah.
So basically, you're a local fighter here in Virginia Beach as well. We've known each other from the past and trained a couple times together, cross paths, and you know, so you're also a massive sponsored athlete now. And I thought, why not, you know, have you on the podcast? So thank you very much for coming on. And I've got some notes here that I'm going to just read off as an introduction. I'm still getting used to the whole podcast as a host. You know, normally I'm a guest. So
hey, I appreciate the research, you know, that went into it. So that's helpful.
So you're 24 years old from Tunis, Missouri. Ranked number 14 in the women's UFC flyweight division, grad student at ODU, industrial and organizational psychology, and you're working on your master's degree. So you're more than just a tough girl.
I try to be. I've been saying that since the first fight, you know?
Smart as well. And you grew up on a farm, moved around a lot with your dad. And you're a big fan of Ronda Rousey growing up, a little bit of inspiration. And your website is fearthemaverick.net.
Correct. Yes. Everybody heard that, hopefully. There we go.
Fearthemaverick.net. So, and at 18 years old, you were the number one ranked MMA fighter in the Midwest. Mm-hmm. Pretty badass.
Yeah, it was.
Started BJJ at 16 years old. Graduated with honors from Drury University in Springfield, Missouri, and in 2018 with a bachelor's degree in psychology and sociology.
Mm-hmm. And so, unfortunately, you know, people that can do math, they're like, why don't you have your master's yet? It's kind of gotten held back, a little unmotivated the last summer, you know. But we'll hopefully have my thesis done in the next semester. I was given an ultimatum, or else I would be well on my way to finishing a PhD right now, too. Yeah.
A lot of people go to college for 8 years. Yeah, they're called doctors.
I guess so. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So thank you so much for coming on my podcast. It's super cool. And we just wanted to kind of give you the floor a little bit and, you know, tell people kind of a little bit about you, about your story and what you're up to now. And
thanks. Well, I came from something just a minute ago, or else I'd be colorful like you in this beautiful wall here. Right now, I'm actually becoming not a local in a couple weeks, if some people have kept up or know. Getting ready to move to Denver, Colorado. I'm actually really excited. Of course, I've grown pretty close to some teams around here, not just my own, but others that I cross-train with and, you know, friends throughout the martial arts community and kids that I've helped teach at tournaments. I just got done going to a tournament a couple weeks ago, and I was telling somebody, like, when you see a four-year-old or six-year-old without a coach going out there and their parents are just like, the coach is busy, I'm like, I'll go coach them. I don't care. It doesn't matter if their team is the same team or different. You just go help. So I've gotten really close with a lot of kids around here and their parents and different martial artists, so that's what I'm going to miss most, of course, is that connection, but I feel like I'll always have it with a lot of people and getting to see them grow through the martial arts community. It's still not huge, so you get to know people around the globe just from knowing them anywhere from social media or seeing them once, so that's pretty cool. But getting ready to transfer to Team Elevation out in Denver, which I'm really excited about. People have probably heard of it, you know, Gaethje, Sanhagen, Alistair Overeem was there, Curtis Blaydes, and a lot of female fighters are out there as well. Like Rose Namajunas trains at a gym that's close by in Denver, Tisha Torres, Raquel Pennington, and JJ Aldrich, a few of those ladies. So I'm really excited to get out there and get some training in. Hopefully going to have Montana De La Rosa as one of my main training partners. Not sure yet, though. See which coaches I want to work with, and I'm just really excited. So in 2 weeks' time, I'll be out there getting ready to start another fight camp and get ready for my fourth fight in the UFC.
Hey, time's flying, huh?
That's all right.
That's nice. Those UFC paychecks racking up. Have you gotten a bonus yet?
I have not gotten a bonus yet, unfortunately.
Come on, Dana, 60 G's, baby.
I know.
They bumped
it
up to 60 G's, right?
I don't think in total. It was just for one. It was for one occurrence. They gave somebody 75 once. Somebody convinced him 60 once. But I think generally it's still 50 across the board. I've been hoping for it, but it seems like every time I'm on a card, it's a huge pay-per-view and everybody decides to knock everybody out. So we're working on it.
That's just what you need to do, right?
That's right. Exactly.
Yeah. But hey, you're ferocious in your fighting style. Love it. And the girls division has come so far back from Ronda Rousey days, where there was only like one or two, handful, a couple girls that were, in my opinion, like
good,
decent, like, at all, and the level of competition was just not even there,
but it just evolves, like women's, you can almost look back, like, now women's fighting is about where men's was in around 2000 mm-hmm. is what I would estimate it, maybe even a little before that. You didn't even see women fighting until 2005, 2008, something like that. And that is how I kind of got inspired, was seeing that very first Ronda Rousey fight in the cage. And I was like, what? Women fight? I had no idea. I watched the UFC with my dad. Yeah. Well, actually, my dad said I could do that. And he was like, you could go do that someday. You could probably be best in the world. And I was like, absolutely not. I don't want punched in the face.
Your dad's in your corner, isn't he?
He is. Yeah. He's in my corner every time, except the time I went to Abu Dhabi, which was unfortunate, but passport issues during the whole COVID-19 thing just made it hard for him to get out there. So took my now fiance at the time was just
that's recent. Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it. It's been another exciting change in life, but nothing really changes behind the scenes other than a ring on the finger. So it is what it is there. But yeah, dad's always in my corner and he's always been super supportive. And there's some people that are like, well, he probably just told you to go fight. And I'm like, no, in fact, he's the one that's probably, I don't know how to say it, but he's like, if you don't want to fight ever again, that's fine. I'm here. Like, I'm not going to do anything,
just
whether you fight
you
or not.
Either way.
Yep, exactly. Like, he loves I'm doing it. He, of course, loves that I've found this talent that I have and have this potential and am going out trying to rock the world with it. But he's like, if I ever have any health problems or anything, he's the first one to be like, stop, don't do it anymore. We're done. No more.
Cool.
And I almost have to argue back at him that, no, I want to keep doing it. Mm-hmm. When the funny thing is, he's the first person who was ever like, you could do that. And I'm like, no, I don't want punched. And then a couple of years later, I'm in there. Dad, can I go fight? He's like, sure, I guess, if you want.
So you started with jiu-jitsu?
Yeah, I did. I love it. Again, dad was always a huge advocate of self-defense, which I know you are too. It's awesome with the whole adopt a cop BJJ mm-hmm. thing. That's really awesome to me. But started jiu-jitsu as like a form of self-defense. As a young woman, I think that's what all women should do, is at least go get their blue belt in jiu-jitsu.
100%.
There's just nothing like it as far as martial arts and learning self-defense. I've done wrestling. I've done boxing. I've done striking. I've done almost every kind of martial art. And there is nothing like jiu-jitsu. Like, if me and you fight, like, and you have no experience, let's say, and you throw a punch at me, you could knock me out. It doesn't matter. I might be world ranked. You're going to knock me out. I'll be laying on the street, dead, whatever. But also, when you are doing a self-defense thing, when is somebody going to stand there and be like, fight me? Like, that doesn't happen, right? So it's almost always going to go to the ground. It's going to be some kind of struggle where they're grappling with you. So I think it's just really important to learn the self-defense aspect of it. And I've tried to preach that to every friend I have, every family member.
Well, let's not just, not just self-defense.
Yeah.
If you want to go on the offense,
right, that too, yeah.
Hey, someone's talking shit or whatever, or disrespecting you, and they cross a line and you're just not having it.
Absolutely.
I mean, you're not going to let some little punk fucking run his mouth, and right. disrespect you like that. And, you know what you're capable of.
Absolutely.
You've put in time, and you're a brown belt now?
I'm a brown belt now.
You just got promoted recently, mm-hmm. huh?
Yeah, I think last November, and I got a stripe knot just a couple weeks ago.
Nice,
so,
congratulations.
Yeah,
but
you.
that's nasty, a brown mm-hmm. belt, that's a whole bunch of knowledge that, even as a female, if you're going against someone that has not trained at all, and you're a brown belt female in jiu-jitsu, my money's on you.
Yeah, I would say if there is less than 100-pound difference, I'd probably win against the average guy. Mm-hmm. That's what I've always said. Yeah, there's a certain point where strength matters. And if they have skill, of course strength matters, size matters. But if you don't, then it is what it is. And like you said, I'm not a person who draws the line at words, but if you touch me, I get to touch you how I want to touch you, right? And that's just the end of the line.
There will be lines drawn with words with me.
yeah, I'm... unfortunately, I feel like with the career path I have, it get me in so much trouble at this point, I'm not willing to do anything. And usually, to be honest, I have other guys around that defend me before I have to do that, which is
As you should. Well, that's awesome. When is your next fight? Do you know?
So unfortunately, I'm not sure exactly when it is yet, but I am hoping for late November. I've kind of given the management team and the UFC a heads up that I don't want to fight until I get comfortable with my new gym out there in Colorado, and that'll give me a few weeks to figure out my coaches and then enough time to have a full fight camp. So late November, but for sure I will have one before the end of the year's up.
So one of the benefits to going out and training in Colorado, for those of you that don't know, is the elevation, hence the gym name, Elevation. But, Colorado is up there in elevation, and that makes it harder to breathe because there's less O2 at elevation. And a lot of athletes go there to train. The Olympic Training Center's there as well. And, you know, when you basically get acclimated after, probably like 2 weeks or so, your body gets used to training with less oxygen, and then when you come down to sea level, you're like
a monster.
Yeah, you're like, oh, all this extra oxygen. What's going on? I got a lot of in the gas tank. So a lot of athletes, that are real serious about their training, take it to that next level, that new elevation.
Yeah, there you go.
That's super cool. And Justin Gaethje's out there, you said?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of fighters are. You know, Sanhagen, who just fought
Justin Gaethje, he's one of my favorite fighters to watch.
I unfortunately love
his mindset.
Yeah. I unfortunately haven't gotten the chance to meet Gaethje. I've met him because he fought on one of the cards that I did, but I didn't get to personally meet him, even though I've trained in Colorado multiple times now. But he was never out there the day that I went to the gym, unfortunately. But now, hopefully, I'll have a chance to meet him and tons of other fighters. But like you were saying with the elevation, it's funny because as a young athlete, I always thought that was BS. I was like, if you have good cardio, it'll be fine. You just got to work on your cardio.
It's real.
Yep. I had my only amateur loss in Denver, Colorado. And mind you, you can rewatch the fight. I don't think I lost that fight either. But she was the hometown girl using me as, quote, a stepping stone to her pro career. And
Roger that.
So I did do the fight at that point. For people who have watched my career, I was not a striker in the slightest. I would take people down and submit them. That's all I did. And for 7 out of my 8 amateur fights, I would do that in the first round and finish the girls. So when I was forced to strike with this girl because she had a ground game that was pretty good, I would take her down and she'd throw a couple punches. I'd take her down and threaten submissions, but matters what the judges, like. And also, she was the hometown girl. It is what it is. But I remember going into the second round and being like, I can't breathe. And my coaches were like, just deep breaths. And I was like, no, I literally can't breathe. And that was the first time that
I felt deep breaths.
Yeah, exactly.
I
had only been in town 2 days and it hit me hard. And I was like, all right, never again in Denver. Well, I'm an amateur. I got to get out here 11 days early and train. And I've done that before. I've trained out in Denver for weeks at a time, and it's always those first 3 to 5 days are just miserable. You're
sucking wind. Mm-hmm. Yep, looking for that O2. Yep. Well, that's super cool. What else you got going on with your schooling? You said you're working on your master's degree. Are you transferring schools or are you doing it online?
I'm doing it online, basically. All I have left is research. My thesis is getting finished. I need to defend my thesis and everything. So literally today I've been working on it a little bit. Over the summer, I really haven't touched it at all. I kind of lost full motivation last semester when I was kind of told by the educational community in my program that I needed to pick either MMA or school.
Yeah, why?
Why are they trying to? I don't even want to talk too much about it because I'll get myself in trouble. But basically, they didn't think I was focusing on school enough, which I think is ridiculous. I got an award for being the best TA this year, which is the teaching assistant. And I had great grades. I've never failed a class. I've kept up with everything. So I'm like, give me evidence as to how I won't be able to prioritize. There is none. But it was along the lines of, well, other students aren't able to. And we were never able to have free time when we were in school. And I'm like, okay, so basically it's a discriminatory,
I was going
to
say, it sounds like they're jealous 100%.
That's how I feel about it,
too. Sounds like they're trying to throw rocks at things that shine, you know?
Yeah.
You're making them feel insecure because, you know, you're able to not only do this thing that they're doing and is, you know, probably consuming all of their time and effort and energy, but you're also a rising star in the UFC and crushing that too. So,
and it's unfortunate because ODU itself, I don't want to talk shit on the whole school because I'm the front page. Like, you go on the website and it's like, student hits books as hard as she does people, you know, and there's a whole big story of me on there because ODU loves it. They come and I've done like gender studies conferences and talked about,
know,
athletics and all that. but I've done all these different conferences and, you know, talked on athletics and academics and talked about the STEM field and all kinds of different things, and then the field that I'm in itself doesn't want to support what I do, which is really annoying. I started to fight back on it, to be honest. I took it to the chair and he was like, well, if your mentor says, which is my main professor, and he's like, he knows you better than we do, so if he thinks that's what's best, and he was like, but you can take it up to the deans and this and that. And it would have turned into a legal battle. And I eventually, you know, once I thought about it down to the end line of, okay, what if this does change? Did I want it to change? Not really. Because if they would have reinstated me as a student, if they do keep me on for the PhD, am I really going to want to work for them? Am I really going to want to put in motivation for somebody who has no loyalty or no respect for what I do? The answer is no. So I was like, even if I go on to continue my PhD, I'll go to a different school. And right now I want to focus on MMA, and I have such a good career ahead of me that I'm like, you know what? God makes things happen for a reason from my point of view. And I'm like, if it is to focus on my MMA, get as high as I can in that, and maybe someday go back to school, so be it. But I don't see any reason to get my PhD at this point. I have actually a good job related to my career right now, or I'm sorry, related to my education right now. And I have my MMA. What is even the point of getting my PhD if I don't plan on going into academics, which I think is one of the worst fields ever?
Well, just in case you needed some reassurance on your decision or whatever, let me remind you that you're a fucking badass, and you don't need these fucking nerds in school trying to hold you back from achieving greatness, okay? You can go to school at any time. Mm-hmm. You know, you can go to school when you're 40 years old, 45 mm-hmm. years old, 50, whatever. You can go to school at any time.
True.
You cannot fight in the UFC at 50 years old or whatever. Exactly. And, you know, especially making the kind of money that that is possible to make in the UFC, you know, as far as a career. You know what I mean? And you have a ton of potential. I think you're very well received by fans, and, you know, everybody likes you from what I can tell. And you put on really awesome, violent fights, and you represent the female MMA community very well, in my opinion. I used to not really have any respect for women's MMA back in the day because of the level of talent just wasn't there, in my opinion. And I was just like, oh, they're in the UFC because they're girls, you know, and they're willing to throw a punch or whatever. Mm-hmm. But now it's like, you look at like that Joanna and what's the Chinese girl's name?
Oh, Yang Weili.
She used to be the champion, and their fight was just like one of the best in history.
Absolutely.
You know, like, regardless of gender, I mean, like, men, women, whatever, their fight was fucking insane.
Yeah,
and even like, the Rose one, like,
there's probably
these
10
girls
women
are badass. Mm-hmm. They are beasts, and you know, and your style is similar to them. You push the pace, you know, you're in there to fight.
Yep.
You know,
my biggest thing is, as I'm sure people realize and you've realized from watching, is the pressure thing. Like, I almost don't know, and mind you, this could hurt me at some point, but I'm like, back up. Like, what is backing up?
Yeah.
You know, I'm like,
retreat?
Yeah, exactly. And it's funny because
I'm the same
fight.
Way.
Yeah.
I mean, you've seen me fight.
Yeah, exactly.
My style's very similar. All gas.
Yep. And I'm like, I fight guys. Of course, I have to back off a lot of times, you know, in the gym. But for some reason in my own head, I have this stereotype, I guess, to where I'm like, I don't train with females. And it almost benefits me sometimes in fights because I see these females. I'm like, you're just a girl.
Yeah.
And I know that's a terrible thing to say as a female fighter. But because I compete with men that are bigger than me, I'm like, I've never been hurt by a punch in a female's fight. Like, yeah, they can say, oh, she threw that elbow at me. I'm like, yes. And then I threw punches right at her right afterwards, right? I've never been shook by a female's punch in a fight, right? I've been hit by a 155er before that knocked me on my butt that was a female, but never somebody my own size. And I think that comes from training with these guys that swing at me, and I'm like, okay, that really hurt. Let me learn to defend and move my head a little bit. I think I'm aggressive, but I try to be smart with it and not use my head as the punching bag, right, for them. But that's been something I've learned, just the aggression and intensity. Most girls don't like that. Most guys don't like that. Like, that to have that kind of style is just rare, especially within women's mixed martial arts.
I agree. And, you know, that ferociousness, I used to say it in my fights, like, because, you know, my fights in the past, people have said, like, oh, yeah, he's not technical, he's not this or that, whatever. But, you know, what you can't say is, you know, I'm ferocious, you know, and I'm coming at you with everything I fucking have. And people don't like that pressure, you know, and it forces you to either defend or, you know, get hit, you know, and I don't give a fuck to get hit. You know, I'm not afraid. And I think a lot of MMA fighters are afraid to get hit. They don't want to get hit. They don't like it. And it's not that, obviously, you don't want to get hit as a fighter. That's not the goal. But it's to hit and not get hit. But you're not afraid to get it, you know?
And to be honest, like, I used to be, you know, before I came to Virginia, I will say, like, my striking has improved so much since I got here. Like, just watching the evolution of my own fights is, like, embarrassing. I want to go hide my head in a pillow when I see my old fights.
I'm the same way. I'm
like,
sure.
What is that? Like, I used to just duck and run from punches and run in, take them down, submit them, right? And now, like, I'm like, oh, okay, I can stand with you if I want, or I can take you down if I want. And that makes it so much easier to fight somebody.
Oh, yeah, you can fight wherever the fight goes, you know? And that's what you have to be at that. You have to train that way and be at that level, you know, to be competitive, in my opinion, these days.
Absolutely.
Like, you have to know wrestling, you have to know jiu-jitsu, you have to know boxing, you have to know Muay Thai, and you have to know MMA. You have to blend it all together. And, you know, that way you're not, you know, if you're just a striker, and what happens when you get taken down? And, you know, and someone starts to strangle you, you're not going to punch your way out of that, you know, a lot of times, or vice versa. If you're only, you know, that's your only trick is jiu-jitsu, and you get fucking knocked the fuck out. I mean, hey, that's going to be a rude awakening.
And you still see people in the top ranks of the world that are kind of like that. That's, you know, crazy. They're strikers, and if you take them down, you pretty much know you're going to win. Like, to me, it's all about, like, how you train with that. You know, you should have people being honest with you and being like, yeah, you won your last fight with, let's say, my ground game, right? But eventually you're going to run into a black belt that beats you up. I'll give Jillian Robertson some credit. You know, she came down and trained with me after our fight, and now I can say confidently she probably is better than me on the ground, both in MMA fights and when we're just rolling, right? When MMA is mixed in with it, yes, I do a lot better, but it was definitely safer for me to stay standing with her, and luckily we game plan for that. Not everybody works with the same game plan. My strength is usually my ground game, but as we get into the UFC and there's these higher ranked girls and girls that know what they're doing, it does become a little bit scarier. But yeah, just go in, be aggressive, and not be afraid to get hit, but at the same time, as you said, like, of course I don't want to be hit. I want to hit you, not the other way around. And I will say there, for about a year after my eye surgery that I had, it was scary to get hit again. You know, it still was, it hurt, it was sensitive, whatever else. And I didn't want to be hit at all. And finally, like, now I'm graduating to where I don't have to have my headgear when we spar and stuff. I'm a little bit more confident. But I also credit that to having training partners that are safe with me and know how to train with me without punching me in the head to win.
Yeah, that's good. And you learn a lot from your fights, I think. Well, hopefully you do. You know, I learned from my fight with Alex Banks. You know, he was a Muay Thai specialist, kicked my leg 24 times in the same spot, you know, and I hadn't trained Muay Thai until that point. And then after that fight, you know, that was probably the most damage I ever took in a fight. And I still won the fight, you know, but I mean, it destroyed my leg, and I had to really, you know, I couldn't even, like, touch it for months. And but after that, I was like, I think I should learn Muay Thai, you know. And then when I fought Brandon Pennington, and, you know, he was a pro boxer, and I thought that he, his game plan was going to be to box me, but mm-hmm. then, you know, he went the opposite and just took me down over and over wrestling. Mm-hmm. And I was like, after that, I was like, all right, I need to learn wrestling. You know, it's like just so that you're able. And now, you know, I feel proficient in every aspect of it. So wherever the fight goes, I'm comfortable. Exactly. You want to go there? Let's go yep. there. And then you don't really have to plan so much for your opponent. You just more work on you and then impose your game plan. Exactly. I'm not worried about you imposing mine mm-hmm. because I'm bringing the pressure and I'm going to make you fight my fight.
Right. Exactly. Yep. Unless they have a certain one signature thing that you got to look out for. It's all about focusing on you. And that's a big part of getting to the top ranks is not worrying about the person standing in front of you, but worrying about that world champion. You know, mm-hmm. like I tell people, I don't train to fight Macy Barber. I train to fight Valentina Shevchenko. And it doesn't matter if that's her name. It's just whoever's the champion at the mm-hmm. time, right? Whoever's the champion, so I'm training goal. To be the best,
that's
right?
That's your goal, the belt.
Exactly, exactly. And I think to be the best, it's not about being the best striker. It's not about being the best grappler. It's not about any of that. It's about adaptability, right? Like what we talked about, is that complete martial artist. And that's being able to say, okay, my game plan was this. It's not working, right? And no matter what anybody else tells you, if you can't hear your corner, let's say your leg's messed up, whatever else is the case, you've got to be able to change stuff up and go and move and win. You know?
Do you hear your corner when you're
Right now, which is pretty nice with COVID and everything. I haven't had a crowd, okay. So I hear them clear as day. But soon enough, I'm going to have to get back to, what? What are you saying? And it's still hard, you know, like you have your head shoved into their hip.
I've never heard my corner.
Interesting. I do have very selective hearing. I only hear my corner, though, and I hear their corner and I block out everything else.
I'm deaf in my left ear though. So
okay. Maybe. I'm actually like 50% in mine. I had ear surgery when I was young. I had ear tubes and they flushed it out and ended up flushing my eardrum out too.
Dang.
So I've had 3 surgeries on it when I was younger and it's better than it's ever been, but it's funny because I can't hear low voices very well. And my dad used to get me in trouble a lot when I was little because he has a lower voice and I could hear my mom and it was like shrilling, right? But low voices I struggled with, and to this day, high-pitched voices, like, bug me so badly. I'm like, don't say it like that. I feel like I'm a dog and can hear higher pitches or something.
That's funny. So Jake's in your corner usually mm-hmm. as well, right? Jake from...
Correct. Jake Chamberlain, who owns the House of Muay Thai, Mack and Simmerzer,
yep.
Is, like, my lead MMA coach, and then my dad.
Yep, and Mackens, he's a UFC and Bellator vet.
UFC and WEC vet.
Okay, mm-hmm. okay. Sorry, Mac. My bad.
Yeah.
But I've had the privilege of training with those guys over at House of Muay Thai, and they're awesome. And you know, it's really cool when the few times I've been to the House of Muay Thai, you know, I like their instruction and the way they run it as a team. Everyone is pretty close knit, you know, tight knit there, and they care and they push each other and stuff. You know, so definitely good group of guys and stuff that you're training with here or that you've been training with here. Yeah. So I'm sure they're bummed that you're going to Colorado, huh?
Yeah, I think a lot of them are. It is cool, though, because at that gym, like, a lot of them are military,
I'm sure they're supporting you, though, too.
Yeah, they're supporting me. And, you know, everybody goes to Denver at one point in their life or something. So all of them are like, oh, you're going to that gym? I'm going to come out there and train.
Hey, there's
you know?
My inn.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. So there's been lots of guys come and go from that gym that have been my partners or, you know, came through and been sparring there or whatever else. But we're getting more and more, like, Muay Thai fighters that are starting up that are younger. So that's really cool. It's always like this couple year skip and then you get more fighters. A couple year skip and you get more fighters. Like every gym I've ever been to, there's like a little age gap between the next group of fighters. And I think a lot of that's just a credit. Like you need those older fighters to mentor the younger ones and they just keep moving up and keep moving up. Like it's almost odd to me to say I'm 24, you know, because, you know, just a few years ago I was the little kid at the gym that I was the youngest fighter and all this, and now I'm the old one. And I'm like, what? Like, you're 20 and
you're the
21?
Old one. I'm 32.
Well, at my gym, we don't really have that many older fighters anymore. Like, Ryan Balimphy's gone and done his thing, you know. Ryan Nugent's doing his thing now. Like, all the
he's
fighters.
He's not fighting anymore?
He might be coming back eventually, but I think he's focusing on his personal life and getting his career goals right now.
Shout out to Ryan Nugent's dog.
Yeah,
I absolutely love his
Gus,
dog.
Yeah.
Gus, he's the man. His dog, it looks like a little Rottweiler that's like that's shrunk down and stretched out.
It's like a wiener dog mixed with a Rottweiler.
So I used to have a dog, which I've told Ryan, and like anytime Ryan posts a picture of Gus, I'm just like, oh my God, give me your dog. Because I used to have a little dog named Chloe that was a, it looked like a black lab mixed with a wiener dog. It looked just like a little black lab, short, tiny legs stretched out. I didn't know what kind of breed it was, just a mutt, you know? And when I saw that dog, I was like, oh my God.
Oh, he's so funny. Like, he'll run around and he can't even hardly make it downstairs because his legs are so short. I'm like,
too cute.
But, I'm actually getting ready to get a German Shepherd on our way to the move in Colorado, which my family breeds German Shepherds. Shout out Maverick German Shepherds. But I'm really excited about that. So we're getting a little male puppy that we're going to be raising out there to be my new running partner and stuff. He doesn't like running, so we got to find some way to do it.
Yeah, well, that'll be a good partner. And those dogs are high energy, so they to run.
Absolutely. I'm really excited. They're big, too, which is why I didn't want an older one. We had an offer to get a two-year-old one, and I was like, no, I don't want to be trying to drag a 140-pound animal that doesn't want to listen to me around. So
that's cool. Man, that's funny. You're like, oh, I'm the old one, 24.
I know, but at my gym, it's that way. We have like two 19-year-olds. We have a 20-year-old, like a 22-year-old. I'm like, oh,
well,
I don't like this.
If it makes you feel better and something to look forward to, 32-year-old Mitch could beat the fuck out of 22-year-old Mitch. So I'm sure maybe like 34-year-old Miranda will be able to beat the shit out of 24-year-old Miranda. And by then you'll be the champion.
There we go.
And, you know, it'll be good. No one will even touch you. So
I'm hoping so. I know I definitely haven't reached my peak yet because I'm still learning every day and finding out how terrible I am every day. So,
well, you get better every day. So, how are you handling the newfound popularity and becoming like well known and famous? Or
it's all like, I guess it is slow progression. You know, every fight more people get to where they know you, and every fight I get, you know, of course more followers on Instagram, and that's one aspect of it. Like I get new messages and message requests or sponsors, which is always awesome. But then there's the other aspect of like locally getting recognized when you don't even have anything on to represent you. That's the cool thing. Like it's one thing when I'm wearing a Fear the Maverick shirt or something that represents who I am and they're like, are you Miranda Maverick? And I'm like, oh yeah, yeah, I am. Like my shirt says it, duh.
Make you feel cool?
Yeah, it does. But when they're walking through Walmart, I had a mask on, a plain mask. This was back when COVID was like full heat, right? Had on all the stuff I had to have on, just like a plain hoodie and some shorts. And somebody, Miranda? Miranda? No, I turned around, it's some random older dude. And I was like, I just kept walking, right? And he's like, no, sorry, I'm not trying to be rude. Like, is your name Miranda Maverick? And I was like, yes. Who's asking, you know? And he's like, I'm just a fan, like I watched your fight, you know? And I was like, how did you know who I was though? Like I'm kind of like, you can't tell who I am. And he's like, your hair. And I was like, cool, that's pretty cool that like
attention
somebody locally
detail.
Yeah, exactly, they just know I live locally, so we're like recognizing who I am. Well, so that's nice.
Everybody here at Massif was pumped when I said that you were going to come on the team as a sponsored
that's
athlete
cool.
And a funny story about you wanting to be on Team Massif. You had reached out to me a while ago before you were in the UFC, mm-hmm. and asked about getting sponsored, and at the time I was already sponsoring like damn near all the local fighters and stuff, you know, that came from Spartica essentially. And like a lot of the people that I knew because, you know, I knew all them and trained with all those guys before, you know, I owned the supplement company and before Massif became like big and successful. And then I just wanted to kind of give back, at least give free supplements to people and stuff like that. And you know, with essentially zero return, you know. I never have made any money from damn near any of my sponsored athletes, but but it was just cool to like give back to those guys and stuff. And and at the time we were just dealing with like craziness that no one has any fucking idea of over the some of the shit that we've had to go through at Massif. But you know, And we're constantly battling and dealing with shit as a company because of COVID and all this
and
bullshit.
Regulations and I'm sure everything else.
Man,
with
it's been a
getting
nightmare.
A supplement company going.
And but for the most part, we're good to go. I mean, I have zero doubts that Massif is going to continue to, you know, and in a few years be a $100 million company.
Yeah.
And but at the time it was just a lot going on and we were dealing with a bunch of shit and I was just like, look, I appreciate it, but I'm really not trying to sponsor anyone else right now at the moment. And you're like, all right, I'm sorry, you know, and I was like, I'm sorry, blah, blah. And then it was like, you're the one fighter that actually fucking, you know, went to the UFC and yeah, took off. And I was just like, of course.
Of course. And you reached back out and I was kind of salty.
Yeah.
I was like,
she's probably going to tell me, fuck off.
I was like, I guess I'll talk to my manager about it.
It wasn't anything personal. Trust me. But I was happy that you didn't tell me to fuck off, and you know, so, and I'm glad that
I like
we
the
have
colors.
You.
That's what pulled me in.
Yeah,
just kidding. But I do actually, I love your guys' theme, so that was pretty cool.
Yeah, well, we're a cool company, and you know, we're supportive, and we support you, and we're cheering you on.
Yeah, thank you. And also,
do you like our supplements?
Yeah, I was just gonna say a plug. My favorite one. It might sound silly. It's not even like one of the biggest supplements, but the berries, like the fruit.
BCAAs?
What do you call it? Yeah. Well, the BCAAs I like, but I'm talking about
the Smashing Reds.
Yeah, the Smashing Reds.
What do you mean that's not a big one? That's our number two seller.
Oh, it is. Yeah. Oh, I didn't know that. I was thinking like more of the like actual supplements would be, but yeah,
what do you mean?
That is
a supplement.
Well, I mean like the vitamins or the BCAAs, the protein. I didn't know that was the biggest one. Those are like my
Smashing
favorites.
Greens are number one. You know, most popular products.
Those are hard to get me to go with. I don't know.
Hey, well, the new ones.
I'm just rough with it.
The new ones are coming in probably tonight, tomorrow morning.
I'll have to try those.
They are the new and improved Smashing Greens. They taste even better. And
I have some friends that have done your challenge and keep trying to get me. They're like, oh, you just got to keep trying them. And I'm like,
man,
I feel
it's
like.
It's a good way to cut weight. That's how I started. Why I started the Smashing Greens thing.
Awesome.
I had no intention of making a supplement company or anything. I watched this documentary on juice fasting or whatever. Long story short, I ended up mixing a bunch of different, you know, organic green supplements and fasted with it. And when I did, I was able to cut, you know, weight like super easy and have a ton of energy and train and all that stuff. So then I started doing that to cut weight for my fights.
Nice.
And that's okay. And then, you know, I had no intention of sharing that with anyone or anything. And I was
all your secrets are out.
Right. But hey, it's okay. I've made a lot of money on it, so it's good. I put the greens out, and just one day I had nothing to post on Instagram, and I was trying to build my Instagram, so I was like, you know, trying to be consistent with my posting, and I was like, well, I guess I could just post what I drink every day, and like, you know, and this is what I do to cut weight for fights, and it just went blew
DMs
up
were
crazy.
Viral,
oh my god,
it's crazy.
The DMs wouldn't stop, and I was just getting annoyed with answering all these questions. You know, I'm like, I don't work with any of these companies. I'm not getting paid to, you know, shout them out or whatever. Right. But people were losing weight, and you know, I like to see when people better themselves and lose weight.
Absolutely.
And stuff like that. My little brother lost like 110 pounds.
Whoa,
using it.
That's crazy.
So, you know, it could be life changing for a lot of people. And so then I eventually just was like, all right, I'm going to just make my own. I had no idea, you know, about the supplement world, nothing like that. But where, you know, where there's a will, there's a way.
Yeah,
and
I'd say,
anything
like
you want to do in life, there's a path, and you can just walk it, and eventually you'll get where you want to go.
I was going to say beyond even the health as far as losing weight and stuff. Like, I've heard of so many people that, like, try the greens and have, like, their gastro, like, all that stuff, like, feels so much better. And, like, my family members, a couple of them have, like, stomach issues and stuff. I'm like, try these. Try the reds. Try the greens. And they're like, how do the greens taste? I'm like, mix the reds in with them. They're great.
Yeah.
And that's how I do it.
They've come
a
long way, because when I first mixed everything up, the seven different products, it was rough, real rough. And
I have had worse, though. That's for sure.
And I tell people, like, you know,
if you do any type of bodybuilding or lifting, you've had some nasty drinks. So if they whine about those, I'm like, you're just whining at this point.
For sure. But don't be a pussy. That's what I say.
There you go.
Don't
There's
be a
that
pussy.
One.
I'm like, you know, they taste like fresh cut grass, you know, but from a really nice lawn and a nice neighborhood,
you
know,
a clean one, a
manicured,
clean grass.
It looks really good. That's what it tastes like. But now these new ones, they're gonna taste actually pretty good.
Okay.
And nice. The new Smashin' Reds, we improved the formula there, added some more ginger and turmeric.
Oh, okay.
And,
awesome.
And yeah, those taste really, really good. And
the cinnamon protein too is
everything.
That's the way to go. That's my favorite protein that you guys have. I've been putting it with like the oatmeal and just like random drinks. I love it.
Mixing the peanut butter coconut with the Cinnamon Toast Crunch protein.
You were out of peanut butter coconut last time I was in here, I think.
Well, we
I
got
think
plenty.
I had it there. I gotta try that one. So that sounds good.
We'll get you loaded up before you get out of here. But is there anything else you wanted to cover? I know you wanted to keep this kind of short because
I'm a busy person.
She's got degrees to study for. She's got elbows to throw. Right. You know, probably out there creating a business. What's on your website here? Fearthemaverick.net.
I actually have not only my own like shirts entrepreneur and stuff like that. I'm trying. I've actually made my new line of gloves as well.
Nice.
So I'm working with HKA USA, which is a glove company that probably anybody's seen that follows UFC and stuff. But they decided to make me their first.
Is that Gaethje's coach?
No.
Doesn't he do something with gloves?
Okay. I'm not sure, but it's not that one right now. Yeah, no, but Nick Sampson's stuff over
Maverick.net.
In Ohio/Illinois/Missouri. They work in that area, which is hence how they first heard of me. But yeah, working with them, I'm the first athlete they've ever designed gloves with, like in coordination with. So I have my own collection with them and selling that on my website. I've got all the way from neon green and fuchsia to random red, white, and blues, you know. So I'm really excited about them. I actually have a special collector one that we're only making 24 of because I'm 24 very soon. So really excited about those. And let's see what else is on my website. Of course, like they say, Fear the Fanny Pack. And what's better than having a Fear the Maverick fanny pack?
There
so
you go.
Got different stuff like that. But I am really excited about the website starting up. And then of course I have my actual job that I do for Hershey. I work for the Hershey Chocolate Company, but I'm a I'm a contracted employee for them.
What do you
I'm
do? Security?
Statistician. No.
What's that?
I do the statistics for their media marketing. So I'm contracted, so I can't say like I'm an official Hershey employee, but
have
I'm
you ever
really
been
excited.
To Hershey Park in Pennsylvania?
They want me to come there. I haven't had
it's
time.
It's fun.
Yeah, it looks like it is. I've been in New York to the Hershey World, and I've been in Vegas.
You can't go pre-fight, though. You got to go post-fight.
Exactly.
So that you can indulge in all the...
I do get free chocolate whenever I want, so that's pretty terrible and pretty nice. I always just throw that to others. I'm like, keep those away from me, especially the Reese's. I can't look at them without eating them. So.
Can't be trusted.
Exactly.
Awesome. Well, so where can people find you on Instagram or social media, all your social media platforms?
Well, Instagram is the main one. If you want to message me there. I try to get back to all of them. Twitter, I'm the roughest on, to be honest. I usually just reshare from Instagram on there. But Instagram is fearthemaverick_HOMT for the House of Muay Thai. Everybody always asks me what that means, and who knows, it might just be Fear the Maverick pretty soon. But go on there, message me, tag me and stuff. If you buy stuff from me, all that, I'll repost.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for coming on, and hope you all enjoyed episode number 2 of the Violent
Ask
Hippie
questions
Podcast.
Too under it, and I will try my best to answer.
Actually, I totally forgot about this, but I was going to have all my guests go live on on my Instagram and do the Mitch Show. Have you ever seen the Mitch Show?
I haven't seen that one.
What?
I've seen you share it. I just haven't gotten to watch it myself. I'm sorry.
How dare you?
I'm busy.
Busy. Man. So.
You have watched my fights. I've got to at least go watch a couple of those.
Okay. So we're going to go live on the Mitch Show, and you're going to be the guest. So you have to say, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Mitch Show.
Okay. I can do that.
And then you're going to answer people's questions.
This is like breaking the third barrier or something like that. Isn't there like a word for this? Like where we're doing like two things at once?
Inception.
Inception, yes. Need the music in the background. Something spin.
All right, here we go. Oops. Block from sharing live video. God damn it. After Sorry, Instagram has been fucking with me big time. So
Instagram's being mean. They're blocking you from everything public.
They are. They're
like, how dare you share your like political you views?
Oh my
this
gosh.
Is not a free country. Block from sharing. Tell you it is.
What the hell? They're not letting me go live.
It's man, so, funny.
So Instagram, as you know, deleted my account.
Yeah, I saw that. So now they've
and
a bunch of other things.
They're just on the warpath against me from spreading truth. And it's quite a shame.
Well,
I'm gonna try
we
again.
Could always do live, like across phones at least. So that's always a good thing. So maybe at one point we can do that.
All right. Well, I don't know. It's not letting me go live. Thanks, Instagram. You fucking communists. And so that's a bummer.
Yeah.
But
we'll have to do it again.
Oh, well.
I'll at least try my best to answer questions underneath the post or something.
Yeah.
Or just
that was gonna,
DM me.
I was going to make that a thing. Where with all my guests to go to do the Mitch show.
That would have been cool.
You know? But you don't even watch the Mitch show, so
I'm sorry. Once I watch the Mitch show, then it'll be more valid, right?
So yeah.
Then we'll I'm getting eye rolls and everything, guys. He's giving me dirty looks.
All right. Well, thank you so much for coming on.
Right,
and I appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right. Peace out, guys.
Thanks for tuning in to the Violent Hippie Podcast. Remember, be kind or else.